I learned so much. I got her recently. I bought her a new iPhone. I gave her an early Christmas gift, and she needed one of those little screen protectors. So, you know, we're going all over the place. Everybody's busy, lines everywhere. I mean, the mall was nuts yesterday. We went to the big shopping mall in Denver. It's called Colorado Mills. It's like a million stores, and everybody, people are going out. Mm-hmm. And, I just wanted to get a simple screen, and everybody, Verizon store, all the stores were busy. Go to this little kiosk. And the guy sitting there, just a little guy. And it says, we repair phones and iPads and everything. And I said, and I went up to the guy because there was nobody there. And I said, you couldn't do a screen on this. He says, I'll do it right now.
Okay.
Perfect. Is that the perfect answer?
Yes.
On a 1 through 10, what was I?
11.
Did he recognize the buying signal? The need, the urgency.
Yeah, because you understood the situation of the entire mall. You're like, you probably can't do this, right? And he's like, I can do it right now.
He said, I'll do it. I'll do it right now. Did I ask the price?
No.
Did I care?
Not really.
Charged me $21 with tax. I would have paid him $50. Okay, because I promised my wife, couldn't get the damn thing done everywhere I went. Too busy, long lines. I mean, I'm the kind of guy, I'll pay money not to stand in line. Okay.
Time's your most valuable asset.
Time's my asset, and it's Christmas, and it's nuts and everything like that. And everybody's out right now. And I learned so many lessons by then we went to a Costco. Okay, I love Costco, and we're up in the mountains here, right? We're in Colorado, not North Carolina. Go down to the Costco, and that's also crazy busy. I love Costco. Man, give me that giant chicken for $4.99 or $5. I mean, I'm a happy guy. So we go in there, and long lines, but one line is moving. I study lines, and I study people on lines. And, you know, there's like 10, 15 lines. One line's really moving fast. And I said, let's get in this line. And we get in, it's two guys, and they're just fast. One guy's on the register, he's fast. Another guy's bagging it really nice and putting it in the boxes and everything they do. And I go to these guys, I said, you guys are great. Everybody else has got slow lines, and you guys are just moving at the speed of, do you have a tip jar? Man, you know, I want to throw $20 at you guys. And they were laughing because you can't do that. You know, I was pretty safe. And they're laughing and smiling and everything because what did I learn about engaging? I study people and how to make them smile or engage them, that which translates to my sales skills. What did I learn at that Costco?
That you learned that those two were the top performers in the cash registers.
But how did I treat them?
Like kings.
Why is that important?
Makes you memorable.
What else? Go deep.
Reciprocity. Like if you know somebody's giving you like great service, you gotta like recognize them for it because no one else may.
When I'm out there going to a kiosk for a phone repair, or I'm going to a Costco or wherever I'm going, whenever I go there and I interact with people, what happens when I use those things that I learn, how to make people smile? Hello, Suzette. Merry Christmas.
Hello.
And what do I learn? We're talking about interacting people. Claudia and I went shopping yesterday, and everywhere I go, I try to interact with people or make them smile or say thank you. I was at a Costco, and the people at the register were so great. I said, I wish you guys had a tip jar. I want to throw $20 at you guys right now, you know, knowing full well they can't accept, you know, things like that. And why do I practice at all these places that I go to all the time? Why do I do that?
To be comfortable speaking with other people, to brighten somebody else's day.
Yeah. What if you practice on strangers all day long at the supermarket, at the shopping mall, at the Verizon store, all these, mm-hmm. we have a lot of interactions with people all day long. And I try to start the conversation or make some. Oh, here's one thing. We're going through this giant mall and one of the stores, Claudia bought a dog calendar. Her son has a new dog. Corky or something. So she found a Corky calendar, but they ran out of bags. So we had to hold this calendar. And then we had to go through the mall through a Verizon to get to the car. And the security guy is looking at us because it's not in a bag. So it almost looked like we're stealing it. And he's giving us that look. And I said, they wouldn't give us a bag. Can you imagine that? I just started talking with him and laughing. I said, honestly, would you want to see the receipt? No, I know you're good and everything. And he starts interacting and smiling and everything like that. And I take away from all these situations. I think people will not start a conversation. Most people, would you agree with that?
Mm-hmm.
They will not start a conversation with a stranger. But if we do that and we practice that in safe situations, okay, what happens when we are in a business, a real business call?
You get comfortable.
Yeah, built up the confidence.
Confidence and comfortable, two great words. How important is that when you're trying to persuade somebody? You want to make an honest buck.
Very important, yes.
Yeah.
Important.
I think enthusiasm sells.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you have to be the instigator. Did anyone here ever meet a tired, sad salesperson?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. When I get a tired salesperson and they have no passion for their product or service, I don't buy. I like energy people, you know.
We try to brighten the people's day when you see them with a face. Are you okay? How's your day going so far? And sometimes they change their attitude when they see you talking to them in a nice way. Guess maybe they had a nasty client before we got to them and they have a little bit of a downturn. But yeah, I've seen that.
I learned all these things. These are three stories. Security guard. Oh, you didn't hear I tried to get a cover for Claudia's phone, one of those protective covers. All the stores, all the telephone stores, Verizon, and all the phone stores, they were all had lines in the shopping mall. Yesterday was a crazy shopping day. And I found one guy in a little kiosk. He was all by himself and it said, "We repair phones." And I said, "You couldn't put a protective cover on this." He says, "I'll do it right now." Perfect, most perfect answer in the world. Is money an objection to doing business when the need is great?
No.
Do you think this guy saw my need? Do you think he read me right? You couldn't do this right now, could you? We're all over this mall. Nobody can put a simple plastic cover on this overpriced phone, you know? I'll do it right now. You had me at hello, Jerry Maguire.
Uh-huh.
Who was that? Who's the guy who was in that movie? I'll think of it in a second.
I'm bad with names. And
me too. It'll come to me in a second. He's a movie star. He's in all. Who was in Jerry Maguire? Somebody has to Google that. Where's Siri? Siri, who starred in Jerry Maguire? Tom Cruise, Cuba Gooding Jr. And you had me at hello. I love that. I think sometimes we give an unnecessary. Do you think people give unnecessary presentations?
Yes.
All the time. Mm-hmm.
All the time. Sometimes you don't have to give. If someone comes to you and they're a 10, they're a 10. They're ready. I need this. Can you do this now? Oh my God, I got to buy this car. I got to buy this house. I need to move. Can you move my furniture? And when they're a 10 like that, what do you have to give that slideshow presentation and tell them all the bells and whistles and all that? Do you have to do all that?
No.
What should you do?
Close them.
Suzette, I love this house. And I'll tell you what, we've been living in the Marriott with my three kids and five chihuahuas. I love your house. I'm pre-qualified. Is it sold yet? What do we need to do here?
Well, Claude, I'm glad you asked. You wouldn't be ready to move in right now, would you?
Have you ever lived in a Marriott with three kids and five chihuahuas?
Oh, not personally, but my best friend, yeah, she went through that for sure. And it was not fun.
I love your house. My wife saw it and everything. Is it available? Can we, I'm ready.
If we can get you a contract and sign it, would you be able to sign it today? Let's talk about money. Do you have money for down payment, Claude?
Yeah. What do you need? I'm ready to do business. I'm serious.
Okay.
I can't stand living in that hotel. We've been eating a bad Caesar salads with the processed chicken and we're just going crazy here. I need a house.
Okay, Claude, I'll send you the paperwork. Can I ask you a favor, though? Can you get that back to me, a small favor? Can you get that contract right back to me, let's say, in 2 hours? We sit down again and we go over any details if you have any questions.
I can get it back to you in a half hour. I like the price and I'm pre-qualified. Do you need any money down or do we need an attorney or anything? What do we need to do? I'm serious about this.
Yep. So let's put some money down. Let's say... But $10,000 will work for you?
I'll give you 20 if you want. I want this house.
Oh, 20 works too.
First dimension, off the role play. You might have got 30. First dimension price.
I know. And after it came out of my mouth, I'm like, I knew I should.
You knew I was going to jump all over you.
Yes. I should have asked.
When a person,
how much would you put down?
What's the danger when you're going to get somebody like this someday and they're a 10?
Yes.
What's the most dangerous thing about a 10?
They're going to fall right through.
They could go down real quick.
Yeah.
So when you, did you ever go in a store or something and you were ready to buy, you knew what you wanted, and then the salesperson started yakking. And you went from a 10 to down to a 8, a 7. Maybe I should hold off. Maybe I should shop around. Maybe I can get a better price. Mm-hmm. Maybe I'm rushing into this too much.
Mm-hmm.
What did that salesperson do wrong?
They present
too much. Yeah.
When you got somebody at a 10, what should we do right away? You said it before, Alan.
You close them.
Close them. Sometimes, no, but I got this great presentation and I practiced it and I've got to show, I've got some great slides and I got to show you this stuff.
Uh-huh.
We can do that after we sign the contract, right? Because we want to make sure they don't have a buyer's remorse afterwards.
What's the $1 million rule? Is someone, when someone's a 10, what are they?
Emotional.
Yes. Can we close somebody? Emotionally.
Mm-hmm.
But what Suzette said is very smart. What's going to happen? Okay, we closed them emotionally, but we still didn't take care of the practical, the intellectual.
Mm-hmm.
How important is it?
It's very important to avoid the buyer's remorse and then changing their mind and ghosting us after the fact.
Yeah. Yeah. Ooh, so sometimes when we get a 10, close them, still got to do the intellectual. Oh, listen, and you might even apologize. Suzette, Alan, I really appreciate your trust and everything. You know, we just met and everything, and you're spending a lot of money. So thank you so much for your trust in me and everything. I want to make sure you must have questions about the house, the insurance policy, the Boeing jet, private jet you just bought. You must have some questions about that. And I want to make sure you're comfortable with everything on this. Okay. I know you're comfortable with your commitment, but why don't we answer a few questions here? Make sure you understand everything. Is that all right?
That's okay. All right. Yeah.
So then you got your commitment, you've got your qualification and everything else. Now you go into the intellectual side just to put the last nail in the coffin. Because what happens when you sell emotionally and you take the money? Oh, this is great. Thank you so much. Merry Christmas. Oh, boy. And you get off the phone. What happens?
Buyer's remorse.
Hello, Suzette Miscallion. Hello. Hello. Yeah, hi, this is Joe Blow. We spoke yesterday about that $682,000 house, and I was the guy living in the Marriott with the chihuahuas and everything. I think I moved a little too fast there, and we might have to hold off a little while.
But Claude, weren't you saying that you were tired?
I have to go. My wife's got an Uber car waiting outside, and we just got the chihuahuas in the. I'll call you after the new year. Thanks a lot. Mm. Can that happen?
Oh yeah,
that's yes. Tell me what that. What do you feel like when you made the sale? You're 2 feet above the ground. You spend that money mentally. Oh shit, I'm gonna do all this, and then they call you the next day or something. And their voice is like this. And they, what do? They break my heart.
Yep. Or they don't answer the phone call. So I'm starting calling. Yeah.
Yeah. So you got to take care of that stuff while you got them on the phone. You only get one shot to close and to keep and make it sure it's a good close. Because if they call you up that remorse thing the next day, that's a heartbreaker.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So good stuff. You learn all this just practicing every day. Just when you go to the supermarket or something like that. I'll see somebody with an Apple Watch on. Oh, do you like your Apple Watch? What's your favorite face? Oh, I love the face you have on your Apple Watch. You know, it's different faces you can do. What made you pick that face? That's interesting. Engage people. You talk about something. Everybody loves talking about their jewelry, their dogs. If you see somebody walk, oh, that looks like a great dog. Oh, I love that breed. Are they hard to train? You know, boom, so easy.
So Claude, going back to what you said, when they call you with that remorse and they're rushing to get off the phone, how would you handle that?
You know, let's go. Want to role play? We'll role play it. When you close them, you have to anticipate that could happen.
Uh huh.
You know, my post sales. You got to be a post salesman. You have to anticipate everything while you're stroking, nurturing. I appreciate your trust. Let me, Suzette, Mr. Allen. Listen, we came to this decision so fast. I know you want to buy this house. You're pre-qualified and everything. Are you comfortable with? You know what I'm worried about? You mind if can I be totally transparent with you?
Yes.
I'm worried that we came into this so fast. You're going to call me tomorrow and say you had a change of mind. And if we're going to change our mind, why don't we just do that right now? Because we got into this so fast. It's an expensive house and everything. Are you sure about your decision? Because you can say no to me still. It's all right. I've got plenty of other people want this house.
Okay.
Okay, what?
Go on.
Role play.
Yeah, you're right. And we really got interested in the house. We're really loving it. I guess we're really into getting out of the hotel, and the chihuahuas are driving me crazy, and my spouse is driving me crazy.
I know. And how long have you been in there?
I would say about a year.
Yeah, so you stay another 6 to 12 months. It'll go fast, right? It can't be that bad.
No, it's horrible. I can't do this.
Okay. Well, the thing is, it's a beautiful home. I think it fits in your budget. You can move in January 1st. We'll have the utilities on. We'll have it all ready for you. If you're comfortable with this decision. If you're not, it's okay to say no now, but you can't call me tomorrow and say, well, we had second thoughts. You can't do that. So where would you like to go? If you're going to say no, we can say it right now. I have plenty of other people need a house like that. Would you like
to go? I said that I wanted it. Why would you say that I don't want it?
You know what? Because sometimes people say to me one thing and then the next day it's another. I just wanted to make sure you're comfortable. Are you ready to make a financial commitment to secure the contract?
Yes, today.
Okay, what would you like? What would you be comfortable? It's a $682,000 house. I can call the attorney. I'm going to get you the contract. You got to get it. Can you get it back to me today? You said already you would. Financially, what could you put down to have a little skin in the game, show that your commitment is serious?
Okay, well, how much would you want me to put down?
I don't know. What's comfortable for your budget? 2%, 5%, 10%?
Can we do 2%?
2% of $680,000 is $13,400. Can you do that on a credit card now? That'll go 100% towards your purchase. And it's an option, so you have a year to exercise that option, and you that money will apply to it. Are you ready to, you can do that on a credit card right now?
Yeah, but can I see the contract first? What if I don't like what's in the contract?
If you don't like what's in the contract and you get back to me before 4:30 today, it's over. Don't worry about it. But I need that money today. Is that comfortable for you? Or?
Yeah, I'm okay with the money. It's just that I would like to see the contract first.
We'll do the contract and we'll meet again at 4:30 on Zoom. You can ask me any questions and we'll either move forward or it's over. Is that fair?
That sounds good.
I'll talk to you at 4:30.
Thank you. Okay.
Contract, money, next appointment, all in one phone call. You can close people in one phone call in many cases, sometimes two, never three.
Excellent. I like that question. Are you ready to make a financial commitment today? I think I need to incorporate that.
Did you hear the scarcity and the social proof and the authority? All three. Sales is a hybrid of many different emotions and psychological triggers. And you got to put them all together. If I go to you like this, oh, well, whatever you want to do, don't worry about it. It's Christmas. What happens when you sound like a weenie?
You don't get the cake.
You don't get the cake, man. You don't get it. Because what's going on in their mind when you're
needy.
You're needy. What goes on in their mind? Oh, I can do whatever I want. I'll call them next week. There's no urgency. I am so easy to close. And nobody knows how to close me. It's so easy to close me. You know? I'm shopping for a new car right now. I spoke to a couple dealerships. And some of them have cars. There's, you know, I know cars are really tough to get right now. A few of them have cars. Any one of them could have closed me in one phone call and none of them knew how to do it.
Wow.
If they're not going to use scarcity against me, you know, I'm going to take my time. I have until my lease is old. I have a lease that's it extends to January. But if someone wanted to press me now to Mr. Diamond, we have the one car you want. I know it's not the color you want, but you know what? We may not get it. We may not get this model again for another 30 days. I've got people screaming. You know what? I'd like to earn your trust in business. Why don't we get you in this car and it's done? You don't have to worry about it in January. You bring in your other car and I'll take great care of you. Nobody said that.
Wow.
I'm so easy to sell. You remember my story? I always love telling the story. Claudia and I are in the airport at DIA. And I said, honey, I'm going to take a little walk. And there's a kiosk selling overpriced $38 t-shirts or something like that. And it was a really nice girl. And she engaged me. And she said, look at this. And she, let me help you here. And she was so cute and engaging. I come back to Claudia, honey, I just spent $85 with airport tax on two shitty t-shirts. That girl knew how to sell me.
Souvenirs, yes.
Whatever. It was a nice t-shirt. But, you know, I'm taking a little walk. And I come back, I spent $84 on two crummy t-shirts. I'm so easy to sell, but nobody, she knew how to sell me. I think we need to engage people.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
No.
I was on the return line and we were all waiting and this guy's like, oh, there's only one person handling returns. And, you know, I took that as a practice and I'm like, yeah, everybody must be out to lunch. And he's like, lunch is over already. I was like, well, I haven't had lunch yet. And he's like, yo, you missed it. I'm like, well, I'm fasting before the feast, you know? And he starts laughing.
When you make somebody laugh, That I think that engages likability.
Mm-hmm.
Make somebody laugh, or if you can make them feel good. How do you know if we can? We need to do this all the time. I do it everywhere, in trying to engage people. And I'm a recovering shy guy. Nobody believes that about me. But I forced myself to change. Why is it so important to engage strangers or your process? Why is it so important to be engage them, get them to like you, trust you, laugh with you? You know, why is that so important?
They're buying your energy.
Ooh, it's energy. Enthusiasm sells, doesn't it?
100%. That mm-hmm. example of, I forgot his name, but you shared it with us before, the potato peeler guy.
Yeah, Joe Atis.
Right. Anyone else could have sold that, but the fact that you know he had the enthusiasm and energy to do so every single day allowed him to propel his sales to exorbitant levels. And I think you said he lives in Fifth Ave or something.
He passed away. He was a multimillionaire. Lived on Park Avenue, and that's Park where Avenue. Apartments, condos, and they sell for millions of dollars. This guy was a multimillionaire selling little potato peelers on the streets in Times Square. Nobody knew that because he'd sell them all day long, cash business. Probably was very good at managing and investing his money. And he always had that constant passive income.
Yep.
Every day he'd go out with his little wagon, his little tweed suit. He had a cute little British accent. His name was Joe Atis, A-D-E-S. It's on YouTube, that video. It's he was on the Today Show.
Yeah.
A little thing on him. I show that when I do public speaking. I show that video. How do you say no to a cute old man who engages you? You buy a couple potato peelers, right? Big deal. Right. You buy them for $5 each or five for $20 or whatever he was selling them for. You give them away to friends. It's a gift.
Right. And you just see the people like with the cash, like handing it to them. They're like,
yeah, cash business. How important is passive income? Is wonderful. Making money every day is wonderful. Not just the big deals. You know, everybody, all the gurus like to talk about, oh, the big deal. Look at all the money. You know, in between those big deals, you can starve.
Have you watched the kid? He is very young guy, and he goes knocking on doors as well, but he's selling some kind of cleaning product.
Yeah.
And he goes very fast, goes through all these comebacks, and it's so funny. And everybody's like recording him when he's going through his thing. But I'm sure he sells a lot because he's pretty good at it.
Why is he so good? He's entertaining. He's
fun. Yes.
He's non-threatening.
He's hilarious.
Do you think he loves what he does?
Yes, he does.
How many people do you meet in their work that love what they're doing? Can you tell when someone loves their job?
Not many people.
I love what I'm doing. I love what I'm doing right now with you guys. I love this. I mean, I'm so, after I get off a phone call like this, I go and make phone calls, and that enthusiasm just, it just keeps steamrolling. It gets bigger and bigger.
I like that. It's a great idea. Phone call after an entourage.
Oh yeah. Use the energy of any of our phone calls or our Monday group meeting or the Wednesday one. Oh, I'm doing a Christmas Eve tomorrow if you want to join. I think it'll be 6 o'clock for you if you want to join me for a quick drink.
Okay.
Or watch me drink.
We'll do our best. Thank you, though. Anyway, time flies. It was a pleasure, guys. Suzette, Coach Claude,
what did you learn?
Merry Christmas.
30 seconds. What did you learn today?
We're here to sell energy and enthusiasm. Doesn't matter what the product is. It could be a potato peeler. It could be a house. It could be a shoe. It could be a car. They're there to buy your energy and enthusiasm.
Yeah. It's contagious. Absolutely. Have a wonderful Christmas if I don't see you tomorrow.
Merry Christmas, Suzette. Bye for now.
Bye-bye. Suzette, I'm going to have 6 o'clock tomorrow if you want to join me for a quick drink. We're going to do a beer with Claude on Christmas Eve.
Okay. We will. Thank you.
Yep. Tell Nick I said hi.
I will. Declare it the same. Take care. Bye-bye.